character creation responsibility. It's a very similar set of issues as with the culture creation. So in this time, it's a question of who creates the characters the people are playing, the organizers, the players, or the organizers and the players together. And again, a couple of just things to keep in mind while considering this. If it's the players who create the characters, there are many methods for doing so. In Finland, where I come from, a traditional method is that it's very actually rare in Finland for that to happen, but if a player creates his own character, it means that they do it alone without consulting anybody, and which is not a great way to do it. I think a better way to do it is to do it in groups or in workshops, in which case you can have a more, because no character is alone. Every character is part of some kind of social dynamic, and you can just start with the social dynamic. You can see, okay, we're a family, so what kind of a family we are. And that process can be guided by the organizers. And of course, organizers can also create characters in these kind of units. And what often happens, even with pre-created characters, if the organizers create the characters, it's still the responsibility of the players to give depth and to sort of flesh out those ideas. I think this is also a fairly common way to create characters, is you get a written character from the organizers and then you work on it as a player. And just as a general question of how important all of it is and what kind of things you need to focus on is the question of how much of the design of the game is in the characters anyway. How important are the characters? In some games, the characters are absolutely the core of the experience, is experiencing the thing from your character's perspective, while in another game, it doesn't really matter who you are. The character is just an alibi for you to be in the LARP, just another name, and then you can go in. And of course, that means that answering that question also makes it easier to answer the question of who creates the characters anyway. So, I will again give you some examples from much of the same games I talked about 10 minutes ago. And from the Monitor Celeste, I think that during this school you will hear from many design choices that worked out exactly as they were planned to work out. But this is not going to be one of those examples. Because sometimes things will happen in the game that are, because there's two kinds of design, the design that's designed and the design that plays out in reality, and those are not always the same. And I will give you one of those examples now. In Celestra, the official design was that you get to my eye, quite extensive organizer-written character, where you have first the baseline of what the character is, what's the position of the character, and so on, and then you get two choices of interpretation of how you want to see that character in the organizer-provided text. You can see maybe the character is like this, or maybe he's like this, and then you can make a choice. I like that. That was a nice way of doing it. However, in my personal case, at least as a player in Celestra, I also got, and people in my group got, very conflicting information regarding our character. Just very basic stuff, that in my character it says I'm a cook, and I've always been a cook, and I haven't done nothing else except cook in my entire life. And then I get another paper which says I'm a secret agent. So, obviously, right there, what I have is a broken character. And when you give broken characters to players, you force them to be creative because they have to make something coherent out of stuff that is not coherent. And that already moves the slider towards the player sort of by force, because they have to contribute to it. And in our case, it led to because officially Celestra didn't have any kind of character building workshops. So in our group of broken characters, we started having guerrilla workshopping to sort of secretly get better characters among ourselves. I think, but that's also design on our part. You are not always the person who controls the design of your game, even though, of course, it's nice to be. And in a well-designed game, you should be. But of course, this was not without its problems, this situation. I didn't say it creates a conflict between players and organizers, just tension. But I think this can happen in many well-designed games too, when the players create stuff for your game especially I think characters, because characters are so personal. What happens is that they will form an idea that they really like. And when that happens is that they think, maybe my idea is better than the organizer's idea. And do the what do they know anyway? So what happens there is that they take ownership of the project, which is a good thing, which makes people motivated, but it also might create some creative friction between organizers and players. And in Celestro, this happened to sort of, in our case, in a kind of mild degree, but I think it can also happen. It can be a problem also. In Halathisaar, according to in Finland, almost always, like I said, characters are pre-written by the organizers, and it's a very big part of the game design. It's just writing the characters. So I just wanted to put that in there, that designing the characters is essential game design. And if the players do it, then it's player-led game design. But of course, players can do it guided by the organizers. And one of the things you can do with these kind of pre-designed characters is to create non-standard experiences. Because if you say that, okay, in this game everybody is playing the member of a middle-class family, and now all of you 70 players improvise a member of a middle-class family, then you are guiding an organized process of player-led character creation. But if you write all of the things yourself, you can put in exceptions and do weird things in there. And maybe this person is in fact something completely different. And we used to do that to have characters who are collaborators or just generally didn't fit the mold of what most of the characters in the game are. And you can do that much easier if they're just all written by the organizers. But one of the problems you can have with this approach of just creating everything by the organizers is that there might be conflict between the player and the character. This is not actually an actual example from the game, but a fictional example from Halathisaar. But imagine that this guy right here, imagine that he's thinking, why did they give me this character to play? Why do I have to be the soldier? I don't want to be standing here. I hate this LARP. I'm only here because I didn't want to say no to these guys. I think this kind of problem you sometimes have, that people get characters they don't like, and the process for dealing with that might not be excellent. So that's something I think you have more of when you have an organizer, just top-down handed stuff. And then we get to the, again, the max and min positions are completely arbitrary. But if the organizers create the characters, you have a couple of benefits. You can have a consistent quality, that you can ensure that all the characters have enough relationships, enough conflict in the character, enough interesting stuff, that you can make sure that people have stuff to play on in the game because you created it, so you know it's there. And you can have consistency of vision, which means that all the characters confirm exactly to your idea of how, what kind of characters you need there to be. And one thing also occurred to me is that you have more alibi. Alibi means that I can say that, okay, you just have to play this character who is a complete asshole, and the player goes, I just have to do it because the organizers asked me to do it. But if you create the character yourself, you have less alibi, because then somebody thinks, why did he create a character for himself that's a complete asshole? But you have more alibi when the organizers just force you to do it, and sometimes you can use this as an organizer to get people to do things they want to do anyway, and that are interesting and fun to do, but are socially a little bit weird to be seen wanting to do, like playing assholes in LARP, which is kind of fun. And but again, it has the same downsides as with the culture creation. It disregards player creativity and participation. It's creatively boring, and also the players are not so invested in what they are doing, and might have characters they don't like, and so on. Again, the example here is from Halathisaar. We were control freaks also with the characters, we designed them sort of top down. The by accident means that this was actually not how we planned. This is another example of how you have two kind of design, the ideal design and what actually happens, the practical design, the real design. What happened to us was that we planned to have organizer written characters that were then workshopped by the players during our workshop day before the game on our Friday planned workshop and give more substance to the characters and so on. But unfortunately, due to practical reasons, we lost a lot of our workshop time, which meant that we had to cut somewhere, and what we cut was all of this character workshopping, which led to the situation that it put our slider up, because it meant that practically the only stuff the players had to work on was the stuff we had written. And it kind of cleverly also created a situation where the players who had been unable to sort of secretly workshop among themselves because they thought they could do it before the game, and then it turned out that they couldn't. That was a mistake, by the way. That was not a great way to do it. But it sort of makes us an example of completely organizer created as is possible, sort of by accident. And the other end is players create characters from themselves. Of course, players can design characters that they enjoy. They want to play something and they think, I would like to play that this kind of character in this game, so I just make it for myself. And of course, it's great to create together, it's fun. Downside is that, especially if you workshop characters together, you get obvious ideas. You have the same people playing same kinds of characters in every game, or taking the same social role, or something like that. The problem where the charismatic guy always ends up as the king. Because, not because he wants to be the king necessarily, but because everybody else around him thinks that, yeah, that guy should be the king. And that is not always very good for game design because it's boring. And of course, this takes time for the players. I should also mention that writing the characters for the organizers also takes time, but not for the players, for the organizers. An example of this kind of design is Capo, where the characters were created in workshops together, sort of guided by the organizers, but created by the players together, working to come up with all of their personal stuff. I think Capo, from what I've heard of players from Capo, is also that the character was not like super important part of the experience, that it was part of it, but not like essential to it, that once you get in the game, it didn't really matter so much who exactly were you before the game. I was not there, but this is what I've been told. And then, of course, there is the middle position, which I think is, like I said, fairly common. Organizers give some kind of characters to people, that this is the baseline of who you are, and then the players elaborate and workshop based on those concepts so that they get comfortable with the characters. One final note I would like to make about this method is that as an organizer, you should know that the characters will change during this process. I've seen this method used in LARPs where, in the spirit of transparency, you will have a wall where all the written organizer characters are posted, so that during the LARP you can see, his character is like this, her character is like that, how interesting. But in my experience, that is the wall of characters who are not in this LARP, because the players have already added so much stuff to the character that those organizer written texts no longer apply. But that is the joy of co-creation. Okay, thank you. Yes.
Could you say a few words about casting? That is the process of who gets to play what characters.
Okay, I can say a few words about casting. Casting means just that who plays what kind of character. It's also actually, yes, you're absolutely right, it's part of this choice also. Because if the players workshop the characters together, it means that the casting sort of happens as part of that process, and who gets to play the king can also be part of just the player organized or the player created stuff that happens in the workshops. But in a more organizer-led approach, the organizers decide who plays what, and this can also be extremely important in terms of how the game works, because casting is also design. And if you leave more stuff to the players, it means, in my experience, usually that things fall into more usual patterns and cliches. But at the same time, people might be kind of happy with what they want because they created it. Also, this is the casting situation. While if you are a game master or an organizer, it means that you can cast against type. You can make people play the kind of characters they normally don't play, which many people find interesting, so it's a good thing. And you can also prevent problems from happening by preventing some people from being in the roles that are not good for them or are just boring. And as just a final casting note, also it's part of casting to just decide who will not play in your game at all. Okay, thank you.